So I'm a psychology major.
Mm-hmm.
This is my fourth year here. Also minoring in biological sciences.
Wow.
So
you'll be graduating pretty soon?
I'm taking an extra year, so
okay.
In spring 2019.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love to. I love learning, so
mm-hmm.
I'm currently involved in research. Yeah, that's pretty much my life. School,
okay.
Research.
Okay.
Some of my hobbies are I like long distance running. So I do that. I spend
jogging.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And
I like the outdoors a lot, so
okay.
I spend a lot of time in nature.
I see.
You
plan to go to graduate school?
Yeah, so I'm kind of at a crossroads right now, figuring out what I want to do. But unfortunately, if you're a psychology major, it almost always means graduate school. So,
yes.
So regarding my disability,
uh-huh.
I have a visual impairment. And it's called Leber's congenital amaurosis, and that's basically a degeneration of the optic nerve,
mm-hmm.
The nerves that lead from the eye to the brain, and that's that happened when I was born. So it's not genetic, although some...
you were born blind then.
Right.
Is that, maybe I should ask you, want to be respectful, and I find many people same thing too, they want to be respectful, but at the same time they don't know how to start this conversation about asking about your special needs, not that to probe into you, but just so that they know how to communicate with you. Can you help me?
Well, usually I don't really have a problem with people asking, as
okay.
long as we're having a conversation.
Okay.
It kind of is a little insensitive when people randomly walk up and be like, have you been like that your whole life? But I generally have no problem with people asking.
Then is that okay to ask you whether are you bone blind? I mean, is that appropriate, or should I say that this is kind of visual impairment, or this is we're struggling with the terms.
Terminology wise,
mm-hmm.
I don't really mind.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not too big on the terms. I think these days, we try to watch out, what we say, which is good,
uh-huh.
But sometimes we do it a little too much.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't really mind the terms.
Okay.
In the visually impaired community, though, people who are like completely blind
mm-hmm.
will prefer the term blind.
Blind.
Just,
okay.
Yeah, and then people who have some degree of vision
mm-hmm.
Will prefer visually impaired.
Okay.
I'm kind of generalizing here, but
sure.
Yeah, that tends to be the norm.
Right. Just help us so people will learn how to start the conversation.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So then maybe let's talk about your situation. Again, I hate to generalize, starting from you first. Maybe tell us, what's your day like?
So my day, just for this semester, I have classes at 9 every day.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of get up around 6:30. I have a guide dog. I don't know if you can see
okay.
him down there, but yeah, I feed him,
mm-hmm.
take care of him, and pack for the day.
Mm-hmm.
And then I leave. I usually take the bus. I live in Santa Clara, so it's relatively close. It's not too bad. So I leave, after eating and taking care of my dog and packing
mm-hmm.
everything. Leave around 8, and then.
Mm-hmm.
By about 8:45,
mm-hmm.
8:50 or so, that gives me time to walk to class. So people who have visual impairments, they work with a professional. They're called orientation and mobility specialists,
okay.
and their job is to kind of orient us to our environment. So they'll tell us.
Mm-hmm.
Where places are,
okay.
what are the landmarks that are around these places, so it's easy for us to get oriented
mm-hmm.
So in terms of school, I spent a lot of time before when I graduated from high school,
mm-hmm.
Before coming here over the summer, learning the route to the bus stop,
mm-hmm.
and from the bus stop on in downtown,
mm-hmm.
To how to get from there to campus, and just kind of getting oriented to the campus in general. So, Yeah, that's the answer.
So, okay, the reason I'm asking, so these are the areas of probably the university, the school will help and to make sure you're at proper orientation, something that an instructor probably will just, can they will rely on the university to support you, not the faculty.
Right, and that's not actually done by the university, it's done by the Department of Rehab.
Okay.
Yeah, which is a state agency.
I see, okay. So then in terms of, well, coming back, and again, we're trying to understand your day, so how do you, you know, prepare for you, do you have any special tricks to prepare your studies and prepare your work, or what can the faculty do to support you, basically?
Basically, so everything's electronic for me, for, mm-hmm. for the most part, so
okay.
I use a regular laptop, and it has a screen reading software installed on it, so it will read a lot of the content that are on the screen.
Okay.
If you don't know what a screen reading software is, it's basically if you use mm-hmm. a Mac or mm-hmm. an iPhone, you have the VoiceOver or mm-hmm. Siri. It's kind of like that.
Okay.
So that's how I access most of the material.
Can I ask you that the screen reader you use, or based on, I guess, your knowledge, is that there are many different kind, or is just a major kind? They have different function?
They do have different kinds. So mm-hmm. for Apple, it's VoiceOver.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And for Windows, there are various different ones.
Mm-hmm.
The one that I use is called JAWS.
Yes.
And it's not the Sharks movie, but
yeah.
people
okay.
always get confused when
yes.
I tell them about it. But yeah, that's one of the most popular ones. There are a lot of open source
mm-hmm.
Free screen readers, which
yeah.
is great. So there's quite a bit to choose from.
Okay. Do you usually prefer Word document or PDF or any particular kind?
Word, yeah, Word is preferred.
Okay.
Screen readers interact with, they interact best with contents that are simple. So, you know, some PDFs are okay, while some are not.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on how you create the PDF. So,
okay.
a lot of the times people just take a picture or scan something
mm-hmm.
And save it as a PDF, and that's an image.
Mm-hmm.
The content is, you know, it's a picture of a content, so
yes.
a screen reader will not be able to you know, interact with those kinds of documents.
Okay. So I understand you have to go through the optical character recognition process
for right.
the PDF document.
Mm-hmm.
So the Word document would work best for you.
Right.
How, what about the PowerPoint?
Do
you have any issue or any suggestion you want faculty to do?
Yeah, I think if it's, you know, particularly heavy on images and
mm-hmm.
pictures, I think it would be you know, helpful to label, you know, what the pictures are.
Okay.
You know, through the use of you know, captions or
okay.
you know, other techniques in PowerPoint. While you know, other courses that are very you know, graphic heavy, you know,
yes.
such as statistics or
right.
other mathematical
uh-huh.
classes, you know, the best thing is to reach out, you know, to the Accessible Educational Center,
okay.
the AEC, and to work with them and
mm-hmm.
the student, you know, to produce accessible.
Okay, then, well, in that situation, I'm glad you mentioned those kind of a heavy STEM area or those discipline has heavy graphics. Will an audio file help you?
In what context? Like an audio file?
An audio file of the lecture or the content.
So like a recording of the lecture?
Right, or they say it out loud because, you know, sometimes for the faculty, for instance, in math part or in programming or how they, if they have to write the instruction or the, basically the script of what they are saying, that may take a lot of their time, so would that be okay? And if they kind of using the audio file basically to say out loud to explain the situation, would that help?
Just to clarify, is the audio file like embedded into the PowerPoint or are you talking about in the classroom?
Either way, I mean, what would you prefer, I guess?
Okay. So I kind of prefer when the faculty is lecturing, so when my professors are lecturing,
mm-hmm.
I ask them to kind of verbally describe what, you know, they're drawing. So
okay.
The other day, we were going over, you know, histograms in you know, normal distributions and statistics, and the professor was drawing, you know, a graph, and you know,
yes.
she was saying, you know, the x-axis is labeled, you know, such and such, and
mm-hmm.
the y-axis is, you know, labeled frequency,
mm-hmm.
and the bars, here are the numbers that are sort of corresponding, you know, with the bars, and it's, you know, it looks rather symmetrical. So that's a good description, and it's actually helpful for the other students in the class,
yes.
Because they can then have the visual feedback they're looking at, as well as the auditory that the professor is saying. So
mm-hmm.
instead of, you know, pointing at, you know, the board and saying, you know, this, you know, is a normal distribution because it's shaped like this, oh, it's pretty vague, and, you know, I don't know what this and that means.
If you can also share with us some of the part that was really confusing to you.
Yeah, so a lot of the, so in neuroscience,
mm-hmm.
We talk about vision a lot,
mm-hmm.
and how I don't want to get into too much detail, but
sure.
how the cells are arranged, you know,
okay.
it's very, very, very challenging to understand.
Abstract.
Yeah, because it, you know, the light, you know, enters the eye, and, you know, again, the light, you know, being transduced into, you know, neurosignals, it's a very complex, you know, process.
Okay.
And since, you know, I don't really know, you know, what vision is,
uh-huh,
I don't really
yes.
have the concept, it was very challenging. And, you know, they were talking about, you know, like, different illusions that you might have, you know, because, you know, our visual system is very complex.
Okay.
So I had a lot of time, I had a lot of difficulty understanding
okay.
Those sorts of concepts, even with, you know, the verbal descriptions.
Okay.
And this is, you know, this is the times where I have to go to office hours and sit down with the professor and
okay.
kind of talk things through.
All right.
So sometimes, you know, you will have, you know, professors will, you know, have to, you know, like any other student,
mm-hmm.
you know, if the student is struggling,
yes.
You know, have that one-on-one conversation
mm-hmm. yes.
with the student.
Yes, I totally, this is a good example because I also hear from faculty, and this is also the fact too, some concepts are very abstract. So how do you describe that? Can you use something tactile? Is that, but there are things even tactile, for instance, the universe or as you mentioned, the cell, how would you, is there any way, so pretty much you're saying one-on-one probably will be the way, right? Cause
right, right. That way the professor can adapt, you know, the explanation to, you know, the student in particular. And there's a lot of different methods for, you know, accomplishing.
Mm-hmm.
And we're just talking about the science part here.
Okay.
So
you have other examples you could share with us?
I mean, in terms of the methods, I mean.
Yes.
So in regarding, you know, the cells, you can, you know, try to explain it by, you know, there are tactile, you know, paper out there, so you can try drawing it out so
okay.
the student can feel. You can also kind of demonstrate,
mm-hmm.
You know, with your hands if you don't have, you know, those resources. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, you can take the student's hand and, you know, say, this is, you know, a cell, and then put your hand, you know, right next to it. This is another cell, and it's arranged this way, so the signal's going, you know, towards this direction.
Okay.
You know, and there's models out there too, so.
This is good. Any other example you can think of that from your experience, something you think that would help you? For students like you to learn?
Not really.
Mm-hmm.
I think the science part, anything that's very visual,
mm-hmm.
Will be a challenge, and obviously for, you know, a person who's, you know, visually impaired. So,
okay.
I think that, you know, the example that I gave can,
mm-hmm.
you know, it applies pretty much to any visual concepts in any course.
What about maybe, I'll think of an example, in the art area, how would you, you know, suggest the faculty to help you understand or appreciate?
That's hard for me to say because
mm-hmm.
I've never taken art.
Okay.
When it comes to
visual,
yeah, visual, maybe like 3D
mm-hmm.
Imaging,
mm-hmm.
a lot of visually impaired people, especially people who
mm-hmm.
were born blind,
mm-hmm.
Don't really have the understanding of 3D
mm-hmm.
in terms of, obviously they know what 3D is, but
right.
on a you know, representation where
mm-hmm.
it's an image, it's
mm-hmm.
difficult. So like you have the dashed lines, you know, for
okay.
the parts that you can't can't see and things like that, less difficult. So, you know, like I said, maybe using the tactile drawing, you know, materials to explain. And you would have to kind of guide the student's hands to different parts and, you know, explain what it is.
Okay. Any other kind of assistive technology other than the JAWS, the screen reader, that you use?
Well, I think every student will be, you know, different. But for me, mm-hmm. I also use a Braille display.
It's basically
electronic system for Braille. So they have, you know, different pens that kind of pop up based on, you know, whatever is on the screen. And you can pair it to, you know, your phone or your computer.
More about what kind of services you have received to help faculty understand from universities such as AEC.
Well, I'll go with the services first.
Okay.
So I've, in a lot of my classes, I requested a, you know, note taker. So a fellow student, you know, signs up to be a note taker and, you know, share the notes, mm-hmm. and then they get priority registration.
Yes.
It's a pretty cool deal for a lot of students. And I do that because obviously I do take notes, but, you know, just in case if I miss something, I can compare notes with the student. I also, you know, utilize extended time, you know, on my exams. Yeah, some of those things are good examples. And mostly, yeah, I just use, you know, my technology, the devices that I mentioned in class.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of faculty,
yes.
Kind of working with students,
mm-hmm.
I think the biggest aspect to kind of keep in mind is, you know, they're just like anybody else, right? You know, they obviously they're not gonna, you know, they might need a different way of, you know, doing things or completing a task, but ultimately, you know, they're gonna be, you know, at the same destination as, you know, your other students.
Okay.
So if you get that letter, you know, don't freak out.
Okay.
Yeah. Everything's gonna be okay. You know, if you're not sure, you know, contact the AEC.
Uh-huh.
You know, they're a good resource, and they'll work with you, you know, to make your course accessible if, you know, it's, if you know, there are some things to work on, and it's not, you know, all on you to, it's not all up to the professor to.
Right, they say, oh, do I have to turn all my materials into electronic readable? And what if they have lots of visual? And these are things they are concerned.
Right.
You can't change it overnight.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, the AEC is there, because, you know, there are students, you know, that, you know, convert all these documents and, you know, textbooks. So I guess thing that the professors can do is kind of communicate, you know, both with the student as well as, you know, the AEC. And, you know, the whole accessibility part doesn't,
mm-hmm.
you know, fall all on them.
Okay.
Another thing I would mention is, you know, don't limit, you know, the student based on, you know, what you know of the
mm-hmm.
disability. So, you know, going into a lot of the science classes,
mm-hmm.
I had professors be like, yeah, this course is very, very visual.
Mm-hmm.
And are you sure you want to take this class?
Right.
And sometimes they phrase it so that it's, they say, you know, I don't think it would be fair to expect, you know, the same,
mm-hmm.
you know, standard from you as
uh-huh.
other students because it's so visual. And, you know, I think it's, you know, that's, you know, a little bit too much because, because, you know, they're already, they don't really know me, and, you know, they're already limiting my, you know, abilities. And,
I see.
You know, obviously I'm taking the course because, you know, I'm really passionate about the course.
Yes.
And, you know, I like the subject.
Mm-hmm.
So, one thing to keep in mind, I think, is to, you know, don't limit, you know, the student. You know, keep an open mind.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think, you know, the professors that I've talked to,
mm-hmm.
who's, you know, had, you know, people who had disabilities, you know, in their class,
mm-hmm.
they say, you know, they do learn a lot, you know, from their students as well, so.
I see, okay. Yeah, I think then what would you say to your peer, maybe student,
mm-hmm.
fellow student who have the similar kind of a different special needs, because many times, as you can tell, faculty are learning from you how to communicate with you.
Mm-hmm.
So then what would you say, I mean, how would you suggest to your fellow student the way to advocate for yourself?
I would say, in terms of the whole, communicating with the professor,
mm-hmm.
I would reach out to them, maybe a month in advance, before the class,
mm-hmm.
and, email them, write a letter, or, write an email saying that, hey, I'm so-and-so, you don't have to go into specifics about
mm-hmm.
your disability if you don't want to, but, say,
what do I need from you?
Right, here's what I need, these are the course materials,
mm-hmm.
That I need. This is how, I learn.
Mm-hmm.
Just a brief letter.
Mm-hmm.
That goes a long way because, if you show up to class the first day, there's a lot of unknowns, right? So you kind of get that out of the way.
Yes.
So that the first day, can be easy. And then you can, meet them in person and kind of elaborate on, any points or clarify any points that they had questions on.
Okay.
And I would say in terms of, advocating,
mm-hmm.
going back to the whole limiting thing,
yes.
don't, if you want something, don't let anybody tell
to
you
stop
that you can't
okay.
Do anything or
mm-hmm.
do something.
Mm-hmm.
How do I put it into words?
Good.
There are, support systems here
mm-hmm.
That will help you. Like it's a pretty tough line because
yes.
it's, you're also, you're advocating, but you have
right.
to learn as well. So it's a lot of things to juggle. But there are, people at the university. There are resources on this university, who will support you. So don't
okay.
hesitate.